Gaudy Night. The night of a college rejoicing or grand feast, particularly at Oxford. See also Antony and Cleopatra, Act 3, Scene 13, line 183. Let's have one other Gaudy Night.
We present Ian Carmichael as Lord Peter Wimsey and Joanna David as Harriet Vane in Gaudy Night by Dorothy L. Sayers.
April the 20th, 1935. Dear Harriet, I know that you do not greatly care for reunions and that sort of thing, but I wonder if I could persuade you to attend the Shrewsbury College Gaudy this year. I have to go abroad for a rather urgent operation, and it might be some time before the chance comes my way again.
Mary Stokes, pretty and dainty, the social centre of her year, had been a most unlikely friend for me at Oxford, where I was gawky and awkward, and anything but generally popular. Oxford. Mary had never missed a college reunion or a Gaudy. But I'd never gone back, at first because I loved Oxford too much, and a clean break seemed better than a slow wrenching away, and then because I was wholly occupied earning my own living. And then...
Prisoner at the bar, how do you plead? Guilty or not guilty?
What would the women of Shrewsbury College say to me, who had taken a first in English and who had gone to London to write mystery novels, to live with a man I wasn't married to, and to be put on trial for killing him, and to be saved from the gallows by Lord Peter Wimsey?
I happened to hear about the case and all that, and I thought there might be something I could do, don't you know?
Oh, be damned to what they'll think I'll go. Nothing could be worse than I've been hurt already. I'll have to find my M.A. hood. What on earth did I do with it? I haven't set eyes on it since I took my degree, but I know I kept it. At least I could arrive in Oxford in my own little car, but I still felt a wave of apprehension as I crossed Magdalen Bridge, the iron hand of the past grasping at my entrails.
You're in the Burley building, Miss Vane. Second floor.
Thank you, Paget.
Good to see you back here, Miss Vane.
I dreaded meeting anyone I knew. I was in no mood for reminiscent gossiping. I bathed, put on a black frock that seemed suitably sober for the occasion, pulled my M.A. gown round my shoulders and adjusted its hood of crimson silk. At any rate, they can't take this away. Whatever I have done, this remains. Scholar, Master of Arts, Domina, senior member of this university.
Harriet! Oh, it's so wonderful to see you again after all these years!
The moment I saw Mary, I knew it was all a great mistake. She was pathetically pleased to see me, but we had nothing to say to each other. Marriage had stifled that bright, agile mind, and all we could do was to chat politely about my books and her children. I thankfully allowed myself to be scooped up by the dean, who looked remarkably youthful to be carrying so much responsibility on her shoulders.
So splendid you were able to come.
Rather brave of me, don't you think, Miss Martin?
Oh, nonsense. Nobody bothers about all that. And the warden's longing to see you. She simply loved the sands of crime. Let's go and see if we can catch her before the Vice-Chancellor arrives.
She piloted me through the brightly chattering women to the warden, Dr. Baring, quietly imposing in her scarlet and grey.
Delighted to see you here, Miss Vane. I was up all night reading the fountain pen mystery.
I wouldn't want to be responsible for depriving you of your sleep, warden.
Now, tell me, have you had an opportunity to look at the new library wing?
It's certainly going to be a great improvement. When will it be finished?
By Easter, we hope. Perhaps we shall see you at the opening.
I shall look forward to
it. But I must be off. I can hardly be late for the Vice-Chancellor.
Gowns, gowns, gowns. It was difficult to recognise people after 10 years or more, though far too many of them had no difficulty in recognising me.
How do you think of all your plots? I can't imagine how you dream up some of the things you write about.
The Vice-Chancellor, surrounded by the female dons in reverential attitude suggestive of a prayer meeting, gave a little speech adorned with classical tags and unveiled a sundial. From out of the crowd, Miss Lydgate, my former tutor, emerged to greet me. It always seemed to me that, as any student of literature must, she knew all of the sins of the world by name, but it was doubtful whether she recognized them when she met them in real life.
You really must come and see me on Sunday morning. It is so heartening to find someone who keeps up a scholarly standard of English, even in writing mystery fiction. Mr. Vine is also a fervent admirer of yours.
I don't think I recall a Mr. Vine.
Oh, how silly of me. You can't possibly know her. She's our new research fellow.
I remember the name now. Wasn't she head of one of the big provincial colleges?
Yes. She was provost of Flamborough for 3 years. But it really wasn't her kind of thing. Too much administration. It wore her out. But come and meet her. She's been cornered by that frightful Miss Gubbins.
Miss Devine's iron grey locks were supported by a forest of hairpins, which gave her something of the air of the White Queen.
Dear me, what a very uninspired young woman Miss Gubbins is. She seems to think I should have torn Mr. Winterleg to pieces for a trifling error in his book on the Earl of Essex.
But I sensed that hers was a mind as immovable as granite.
It's a great mistake to see one's own subject out of proportion to its background. The error should be corrected, of course.
Mr. Vine, I've brought along somebody I know you're anxious to meet. This is Miss Vane.
Oh, how delightful. Oh, do let me say how much I enjoyed your last book. I was discussing it with Professor Higgins, and he suggested a most interesting possibility.
Ah, so that's where you've got to. The Vice-Chancellor's taken himself off so we can get rid of this filthy old bombazine and show off our party frocks. Give me your gown, Miss Vane. Has it got your name on it?
Yes, it has.
You too, Mr. Vine.
Oh, thank you.
I'll chuck them into the senior common room.
Yes, I can't. Oh, dear. Is my hair untidy?
It is a trifle. Let me help you.
Thank you. That's very kind.
The afternoon passed off reasonably painlessly. The dons fell ravenously on the cakes and ices. The only unpleasantness was provided by Miss Hilliard, the history tutor who had never liked me.
Well, Miss Vane, you've had some very varied experiences since we saw you last.
At the Gaudy dinner, Mary Stokes had grabbed the place next to mine. I hoped that the screeching of 200 female voices would make conversation impossible, but Mary still managed to come up with a question I'd been praying no one would ask.
Do tell us about Lord Peter Harriet. What is he really like?
Seeing that he got me out of prison and probably saved me from being hanged, I'm naturally bound to find him delightful.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't think.
And I did not fare much better when I took coffee with the dean and members of the senior common room, where I was obliged to give a summary of the book I was working on. A fellow, who answered to the name of Miss Barton and who seemed rather obsessed with criminal reform, pounced upon me before I had a chance to finish.
Forgive me, Miss Vane, for speaking frankly, but after your own horrible experience, I wonder that you care about writing that kind of book.
I know what you're thinking, that anyone with properly sensitive feelings would rather scrub floors for a living. But I should scrub floors very badly, and I write detective stories rather well. I don't see why proper feelings should prevent me doing my proper job.
Oh, but surely you must feel that terrible crimes ought to be taken seriously and not just made into an intellectual game. I mean, this Peter Whimsy.
And suddenly everyone, the dean included, began to ask me questions about Peter, and I was hard-pressed to keep my temper. Fortunately, from the far end of the room, the bursar raised the subject of the college drains, on which all the fellows seemed to have something to say, and it was soon time to retire. Mr. Vine insisted on walking back with me to Burley Building.
Miss Vane, I admired you for speaking as you did tonight. Oh. I imagine you come across a number of people who have very decided views about what you ought to feel about your very unpleasant experiences. It is fatal to pay the smallest attention to them.
Yes, but everything begins to take on such a different aspect here in Oxford. Should I really be churning out trivial detective stories or devoting myself to some form of academic study? How is one to know which things are really of overmastering importance?
We can only know that when they've overmastered us. Good night.
And she vanished with her long, stooping stride beneath the hall archway. I was too restless to go to bed, and for some minutes I paced to and fro in the quad. My eye was caught by a sheet of paper fluttering across the grass. I caught it up and took it inside to look at it in the light. It was a childish drawing of a naked female figure inflicting savage and humiliating outrage upon someone in a cap and gown. A nasty, dirty, and lunatic scribble.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.